indeed a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft, and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, now we will commence with our session. The first topic of first session is on examining international relations through India's strategic culture. For this, we have Dr. Arvind Gupta, Director of Vivekananda India Foundation, as the chair. And participants are the participants from College of Air Warfare, Hyderabad, Group Captain Mahinder Singh, Group Captain Amit Mahajan, Wing Commander Dennis Joy, Wing Commander Hitesh D. Gala, and Commander P. Harshvardhan. May I request chair and panelists to kindly come up on stage.
Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this WASP program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, now we'll commence with our session. The first topic of first session is on examining international relations through India's strategic culture. For this, we have Dr. Arvind Gupta, Director of Vivekananda India Foundation, as the chair. And participants are the participants from College of Air Warfare, Hyderabad, Group Captain Mahendra Singh, Group Captain Amit Mahajan, Wing Commander Dennis Joy.
Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at air headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and a key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, real politics, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain SP Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind.
Thank you, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, now we will commence with our session. The first topic of first session is on examining international relations through India's strategic culture. For this, we have Dr. Arvind Gupta, Director of Vivekananda India Foundation, as the chair. And participants are from...
Here, Kautilya encapsulates Saptang as the seven prakritis, which can be seen on the slide. The Swami, the Amatya, the Janpad, Durg, Kosh, Dand and Mitra. Notably, here the capital city of the Saptang of the Mahabharat becomes the fort or the Durg. In the Shadgunya, in Arthashastra, it is propounded as Sandhi, Vigraha, Asan, Yan, Samashray and Dvaidibhav, and here too subtle differences emerge when compared to the Shadgunyas in the Mahabharat. Lastly, the Upayas of Sam, Dan, Bhed and Dand are propounded in the Arthashastra as a means of politics. Moving on to the Rajamandala theory of Arthashastra, it was propounded by Chanakya to describe the management of relations among the circles of friendly and enemy states surrounding the king's own state. In Kautilya's times, this was based upon the geographic locations of the states. Today, however, the same may be applied based on geopolitical considerations in an interconnected world. A basic guiding principle in this theory remains the following. A neighboring state possessing a potent saptang is a natural adversary. Therefore, the adversary's enemy, who is naturally predisposed to you as your friend, must be cultivated as such. The grand strategic preferences in the Rajamandala theory were thus determined after a very, very objective analysis. Though the Shadgunya remained largely the same from Mahabharata to Arthashastra, the order of the Saptang had changed in the prakritis of the Arthashastra. Note that here, the armed forces slipped from the fourth to the sixth place, and similarly, the treasury also slipped from the third to the fifth place. The Upayas of Sam, Dan, Bhed and Dand placed the use of force as a last resort now. In the period after Kautilya, it was the Gupta Empire which last exercised influence over most of Bharatvarsh. Subsequently, India fragmented into numerous smaller states. It is probable that the change in the precedence of use of military and hard power affected the future of the state and created conditions for internal rivalries and fragmentation of the state. But there is no doubt that the period after the Gupta Empire saw this vulnerability of the Indian state getting exploited by a string of invaders. The Upayas of Sam, Dan, Bhed and Dand were interpreted by various kings differently. Shivaji and Maharana Pratap used guerrilla warfare and grey zone tactics against a numerically superior enemy, and they never compromised on independence. While others used these upayas defensively to avoid wars by paying tributes and taxes, even at the cost of overtaxing their own populations. This transformation of a state to a vassal state and then a protectorate continued from the Mughal times to the British times. The need for iteration in the elements of national power with changing times was understood by kings like Shivaji, who built up the Maratha Navy. Lastly, the rich Indian culture was seen by Europeans as an impediment to their rule, which needed to be subverted. The rule of the Raj could only have been made possible by overlaying a new narrative, be that of the white man's burden or of civilizing the uncivilized. Through a systematic and institutional subversion, the British carried out an inversion of strategic culture in which the connect of Indians with their ancient wisdom of statecraft was lost. However, things changed after independence as the control of the nation was regained, and this trajectory of our strategic culture after independence will now be explored further.
Before examining the foreign policies of independent India, we must first understand the modern theories which explain the approach of various states of the world towards international relations. Emerged after the First World War, the theory of idealism is based on the principle that man is good by nature. Also referred to as liberal theories, they bring out the significance of ideas, norms, multinational institutions and cooperative endeavors in the realm of international relations. International cooperation, collective security mechanism and promotion of democratic values can reduce conflicts and foster peace. On the contrary, realism states that nations are working to increase their own power. States who manage to accumulate power most efficiently will thrive. A nation's interest should be self-preservation and continually gaining power as global anarchy exists and states are constantly at competition. Neorealism, also known as structural realism, coined by Kenneth Walsh in the year 1979, focuses on the structure of international relations rather than individual states. According to him, states are rational actors that seek to maximize their own power till balance is achieved. Neorealism assumes that all states have offensive military capability. One can never be certain about the intentions of other states, and there is no central authority or hierarchy. Neorealism offers a structural explanation of international relations, focusing on interactions and dynamics of states within the international system. Having examined the wisdom of ancient texts and gone through some of the established IR theories, we realize that there are definite parallels between them. Many modern theories can be explained through our strategic culture, thoughts in Ramayana, Mahabharata, Arthashastra and various Nitis and Shastras. International relations of a nation in terms of policies and behaviors flow from the combination of its strategic culture, geopolitical construct, pursuit of national interest and personalities of decision makers. In the 77 years of post-colonial rule, India's foreign policy and its strategic behavior can be broadly divided into three eras, namely 1947-64 under the premiership of Pandit Nehru, 1965-1990 of foreign policy transformation, and 1990 and beyond of for India coming of age. The era of 40s and 50s was largely aligned to Vedic thought of Sarve Bhavantu Sukhinaha, Sarve Santu Niramaya. India's lack of experience, absence of established institutional framework for international engagements, and Prime Minister Nehru's world view led to personality-centric Indian foreign policy. Additionally, India was economically fragile and undergoing political consolidation. Under such circumstances, foreign policy was tailored to provide a moral standing against alliances and an environment of peace and stability in the region, while providing financial and humanitarian assistance as well as cooperation in the field of higher education and industrial development. The societal sense of exploitation at the hands of British Empire led to aversion with cooperation with the West. Vagaries of the two wars, which led to the death of 1,50,000 Indian soldiers, created psychological abhorrence to alignment with either of the superpower-led military alliances and an adoption of non-alignment policy. Indian leaders
profoundly empathize with people in Asia who had suffered similar evils of colonialism and imperial domination. The idea of pan-Asianism led Pandit Nehru to believe that India and China had been united by the most intimate cultural ties of 3,000 years.
Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at air headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, real politics, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this WASP program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and a key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors like George Stanham occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain SP Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. it is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC and I quote what he said. The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools, unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at air headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors like George Tenham occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant CAW AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, real politics, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain SP Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this WASP program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized real politic and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and a key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Stanham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said, "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at air headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft, and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant CAWP AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said, "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. The There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, real politics, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant COB AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this WASP program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at air headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors like George Tenham occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said, "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and a key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft, and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant CAWP AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this vast program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and a key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Stanham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant Corp AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain R.R. Chaudhary and Group Captain S.P. Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind. Esteemed veterans, scholars, warriors, members of the media, ladies and gentlemen, good morning to all of you. Indeed, a privilege for me to stand here this morning to deliver the keynote address on marking the culmination of the third warfare and aerospace strategy program, which I think is a path-breaking initiative of the Indian Air Force. With an aim to develop sound understanding of operational art and strategy, this program has enabled us to refine the definition of scholar warriors. Modern warfare is characterized by rapid technological advancements, asymmetric threats, and the need for a comprehensive understanding of geopolitical, social, and cultural contexts. This multifaceted landscape requires military personnel who are not only adept at combat, but also possess a deep understanding of the broader implications of their actions. Therefore, in my opinion, a scholar warrior is a military professional who combines intellectual acumen with combat prowess in today's increasingly complex and dynamic security environment. It is essential for us to recall the words of Thucydides back in 400 BC, and I quote what he said: "The society that separates its scholars from its warriors will have its thinking done by cowards and fighting done by fools," unquote. Over the last 3 years, I have seen this WASP program grow in stature. Feedback from the previous courses has enabled us to distill and refine the structure of this edition, which was conducted in parallel at CAW and CAPS. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members, guest speakers, and subject matter experts for having taken the 18 participants through the rigors of the course and giving them a rare insights into strategy and geopolitics. It took us a lot of debating and discussions at length at Air Headquarters and at both these institutions to agree upon the theme for this capstone seminar. And I think a very apt theme was finally chosen, which is India's strategic culture and imperatives for contemporary national security. Our strategic culture is shaped by historical experiences and the ever-evolving geopolitical environment. It emphasizes on strategic autonomy, caution, and a strong focus on territorial integrity. The contemporary security landscape presents multifaceted challenges, from border disputes and terrorism to cyber threats and regional volatility. To navigate through these turbulent times and secure our national interests, India must invest in modernization of its armed forces, strengthen strategic partnerships, promote indigenous defense production, and adopt an integrated approach to both internal and external security. India's strategic thinking can be traced back to ancient texts like the Arthashastra, written around 4th century BCE. It emphasized realpolitik and strategic pragmatism, shades of which are visible today in every way we are dealing with contemporary issues. The colonial experience taught us to remain ever cautious and adopt a sovereignty-centric approach towards foreign policy and defense. Atmanirbharta and Make in India are therefore an offshoot of our strategic culture and are key towards preserving national security. India's strategic culture and grand strategy has been vigorously debated within the country and across the globe. Some authors, like George Tenham, occupy one extreme by concluding that Indians have not been great developers of strategy and they do not see the need for a grand strategy. On the other hand, there are thinkers who assert that the practice of statecraft in India has been witnessed throughout history, and epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata display India's grand strategic thought. There is also a cogent argument that many great empires from the Mauryan period onwards have survived and thrived, which was not possible without an effective grand strategy. In fact, some would strongly argue that India's tradition of realistic strategic thought is probably the oldest in the world. Whether India has a strategic culture or not is a matter of opinion. However, realpolitik, statecraft and diplomacy have always been a part of our historical tapestry and have shaped contemporary geopolitics. The Honorable External Affairs Minister, Dr. Jaishankar, in his recent book, Why Bharat Matters, offers a novel approach to contemporary complex international situations by presenting his perspective through the lens of the epic Ramayana. It is indeed heartening that the Honorable Minister took time from his busy schedule last month to interact with the participants of this course. I am sure that this interaction has given the participants of this program an insight into another school of thought that needs to be studied, and I am confident that glimpses of the same will be seen in the various presentations and discussions being held today. In the end, I would like to place on record my appreciation to all concerned involved in this edition of the WASP, especially the program mentors, DG CAPS AVM Gulani, Commandant COB AVM Vadodkar, and the course directors, Group Captain Nara Chaudhary and Group Captain SP Singh, along with all the faculty members. I would also like to thank RRU for becoming involved in this program and facilitating the award of a diploma to the course participants. My congratulations and compliments to all the course participants for embarking on this rigorous academic journey, and I wish you all the very best for the future. May you keep your thinking hats on, because in the words of Albert Einstein, creativity is seeing what everyone sees, but thinking what no one else has thought. Thank you, and Jai Hind.